This is Madinat Yanbu Al-Sinaiyah today. It is not your everyday city. In fact, never before and never again is an apt phrase used by the kingdom leaders to describe what has happened here. In the 20 years that has gone into the making of Yanbu, many thousands of workers from some 40 countries communicating with each other in over 50 languages have contributed to the monumental effort.
Saudi Arabia Parsons Limited has been the management service contractor for the Royal Commission of Jebel and Yanbu from the beginning, with the Ralph M. Parsons Company providing the initial master plan. This film, Jewel of the Red Sea, is a story of that endeavor, and it is dedicated to the more than 5,000 SAPL employees who each in his own way helped make the dream of Yanbu become a reality.
We came for many reasons, and it is important to note that 3 out of 4 chose to remain for a second contract, many staying over 16 years now. Why did you come? Well, for some it was the adventure and a better future. For others, it was a chance to become part of the biggest construction effort the world has known. But for all that has been achieved, Yanbu won't reach its full potential for years to come. Jewel of the Red Sea is a depiction of the colossal building effort to date and of the job that remains. Over $7 billion for infrastructure alone has been expended. A tour is taken through the community today. Familiar camps, landmarks, and popular restaurants are revisited. The film also takes you through the streets of Old Town and nearby Yanbu Al-Bahr, into the gold souks aboard a fishing dhow on the Red Sea with singing Bedouin fishermen, and to the weekly fish auction. It takes you into the tents and touches on the life of the Bedouins that live at the foot of the nearby Ragwa Mountain, and a tour is offered of several of the desert oasis villages that dot the desert landscape.
With that, we invite you to sit back and enjoy a nostalgic revisit to the unique world city to which you contribute an important slice of your life, Madinat Yanbu Al-Sinaiyah, the industrial city.
For thousands of years now, Arabia has been covered by a vast desert, rugged, unforgiving, always changing, adapting. This was Yanbu just 20 years ago, barren terrain where an occasional Bedouin with his herds of sheep, goats, and camels could be seen passing through. Today it is a different story. Here exists a thriving modern world energy center, a technological and engineering marvel, a colossus representing a total investment of over $16 billion, with half that amount being spent on infrastructure alone. It is here that the Royal Commission for Jebel and Yanbu and its management service contractor, Saudi Arabia Parsons, have managed the planning, construction, and operation of an industrial city, which in a few short years has developed networks of industry and commerce that spans the globe. It is, quite simply, a bright jewel on hot sands touching the Red Sea and the Hejaz Mountains. It is a city with the best possible environment and resources for the family. It is Madinat Yanbu Al-Sinaiyah, an expanding industrial city, a city with ample opportunity for enterprise and development.
Yanbu has come a long way from a bare desert terrain, and in the next few minutes I'd like to take you on a tour of Yanbu today. While the boom period of the early 80s is long past, we are now on the threshold of another expansion period where the private sector will be investing in industrial, commercial, residential, and recreational projects. One exciting development today is the attention being given to Yanbu's waterfront potential. The private sector is being encouraged to develop the city center, a marina, and the recreational island. Windsurfing and boating are now part of our local recreational scenery. Already, the Royal Commission is providing a boat ramp and dock, making for easy access to the Red Sea and the city center bay from within the community. Major infrastructure expansion is also underway. Work on 2 additional desalinization units is now in progress, and work has started on the construction of 6 additional new schools to help keep up with a 19% yearly student growth. a major effort is also being made to obtain funding approval for two new steam power plants to help support the increased demand for electricity. Why this expansion? Well, for a start, the pumping capacity of the Trans-Kingdom pipeline bringing crude oil to Yanbu has already been increased by over 40%, now up to 4.5 million barrels per day. And once Yanbu's supply of power and water is increased, existing industries will expand and other new companies will become part of our industrial city. With this industrial expansion will come more than 3,000 new jobs within the next 5 years. A new boom in home construction is well underway as the major industries and private individuals are about midway in constructing some 2,500 new homes.
Now, let us embark on our tour, starting with heavy industry. This is the terminus of the oil and gas pipelines from the western region, where the product is cooled before being stored at Saudi Aramco's crude oil terminal. A new 1.5 million barrel capacity storage tank has been added to the already huge 11 million barrel tank farm. Aramco has already constructed a new marina terminal, badly needed with the expanded capacity of the pipelines bringing product to Yanbu. The Saudi Aramco Yanbu refinery has plans to increase its capacity of refined products from 170,000 to 300,000 barrels per day. The plan is also to add new processing units within 5 years and increase the number and variety of its products. We're now looking at Saudi Arabian Mobil, one of the world's largest grassroots refineries. The plant has just added MTBE octane enhancer units to make its product more environmentally friendly and to add new markets to its already prospering world sales network. SABIC is busy constructing new plants at Yanbu and expanding existing ones. The Yanbu Petrochemical Company is a huge success story, and SABIC is to construct a replica of the existing plant which will allow new products to be added. Construction of a new polyester plant has just been completed, and it will get feedstock from a soon-to-be-built PTA plant. SABIC is also constructing an aromatics plant. Lubref 2 is constructing a 2 million barrel per year plant producing lube oil-based stocks, which provides feedstock to nearby Arabian Gulf Oil Company. The presence of these heavy industries has spawned many secondary and light industries, and there's room for many more. Some are accommodated in the 400-hectare light industrial park, where industries range from steel fabrication and concrete products to an automatic bakery. All this industry requires people to run it, and so the infrastructure had to be set up to meet the needs such as power, water, wastewater, irrigation, solid waste disposal, streets, sidewalks, lighting, fire and police stations, schools, mosques, shopping, recreational facilities, and a hospital. Additionally, a new 400 female staff housing complex has been completed to support the impressive 342-bed medical hospital. A drawing card for industries to Yanbu is this impressive 15-kilometer-long King Fahd port, completed by the Royal Commission in 1982. The port was turned over to Saudi Arabian Seaports Authority, who direct all ship from its 10-story control tower. The port includes 7 terminals with 24 berths, a service harbor, bulk cargo and container handling equipment, and marine support facilities. It is one of the premier ports in the world. A good place to work and a high quality of life are important in attracting and holding qualified Saudi employees, but it is the housing that makes the difference. And at Yanbu, the spacious, comfortable homes make possible through generous housing programs satisfy Saudi dreams of a better life and a brighter future. At Yanbu, Saudis and expatriates enjoy a remarkable standard of living. The modern seaside community is certainly attractive, but more than that, there is a unique village-like atmosphere that has been created. The Royal Commission housing has been arranged into separate neighborhood communities. Each home is within walking distance of several centrally located shopping centers, recreation centers, and parks. It is a green community, which is the single most noticed fact by those returning after an absence. The large trees and green vegetation has distinguished Yanbu from the other Saudi cities. The rapidly expanding permanent community at Yanbu is no longer bounded within High Al Samari and High Ragwa. It now includes homes at High Al Jabriya, High Al Makil, High Khalid, High Al Oum, and Hyalsu. Under its home ownership program, Aramco has completed construction of 200 new homes for its employees, and over 500 more are to be built starting next year. Yanbet has just constructed 200 new homes for its employees and is building some 300 more. Penrith is constructing 163 homes in the first phase of its home building program. Most all available home sites have been reserved now, and Saudi individuals are privately building such homes as these, many located with a view of the Red Sea. Camp 2, a popular community for expatriates since workers first moved on site from 1979 from the pioneer camp down the road, is still available to employees of various Royal Commission contractors. Camp 4 remains home to SAPL married status employees, contract managers, and Saudis. And almost unchanged, the familiar Shangri-La is still one of the favorite restaurants, as is the Baki Palace over in Camp 2. Other fast food establishments and restaurants keep pace with the increasing population and are scattered throughout the community and in nearby Yanbu Al-Bahr. Residents can tell when the royal family is in town by the increased activity at the guest house. And of course, the rest of Al-Nawa village is still very much in use by the Royal Commission, even though it was initially planned to be temporary. Yanbu's location on the edge of the beautiful and pristine Red Sea, with the Hejaz Mountains and deserts just a short drive away, is causing many developers to focus on its potential as an in-kingdom tourist and recreational destination. Construction of the City Center Hotel, a recreational island, and other waterfront developments are all under serious discussion with potential private sector developers.
There's more ahead for Yanbu. The population today is a little more than a peak construction in 1983, about 40,000 people. But this is less than one-third the amount the city is expected to reach. For Saudi Arabia Parsons employees on assignment in Yanbu, this project has meant an opportunity to participate in one of the largest and most challenging projects in history. As the story of Yanbu continues to be written, Saudi Arabia Parsons is proud to be part of this progress.
Today, it is hard to realize that just a few years back, as far as the eye could see, there was nothing here but desert. Then, thanks to the wisdom of His Majesty and other kingdom leaders, one day in 1977, 500 men came. They lived in tents and built a camp where 1,900 men could live. They built a village for 8,500 more, who in turn built housing for another 26,000. Most all those workers are gone now, but in their place, 40,000 permanent Saudi and expatriate citizens reside on site, with another 15,000 who commute to work each day. Most importantly, that desert terrain that once was here has given life to a thriving, modern industrial city, a miracle that is still maturing. Much has been done. Many records have gone into the books, but there is still a great deal left to do. For those of us at SAPL who have been a part of it, is an achievement we may never again in our lives equal. The vision that stirred imaginations of planners and designers worldwide began to be implemented in 1978 as construction started at Jebel and Yanbu. A true wonder was unfolding. It was soon called the largest single construction project in the history of the world. The two cities were a staggering $37 billion investment designed to alter the face of Saudi Arabia. A nation supported solely by its exportation of crude oil was on the threshold of becoming a giant producer of petrochemical products. An astonishing total of 250 separate construction contracts were to be awarded. Hundreds of millions of cubic meters of earth was to be moved. 70 million at Yanbu alone. Over 80,000 construction workers from 60 countries was swiftly mobilized to help build the twin projects. Three shifts a day they worked at first to complete the infrastructure. At Yanbu, there have been none of the elements required for a city to exist. No roads, power, water, communication, or houses. Just barren terrain. This was to change almost overnight. So fast, in fact, that workers were eyewitnesses as twin cities rose from the desolate terrain, like desert flowers after a rain. So intense was the building effort that before even the workers could realize it, there was an infrastructure in place, a power, water, and desalination plant, paved roads, and a computerized traffic system, a fiber optic cable and satellite relay system, a cable TV network, a seawater cooling facility, sanitary and industrial wastewater treatment facilities, an impressive seaport, and a regional airport to accommodate today's modern jets. In the early days, all this infrastructure work was much in evidence. But today, many of the elements, such as unsightly telephone and power lines, are out of sight, buried underground, never seen by most of the residents living above, but silently providing the services necessary to the day-to-day operation of this modern industrial city. Let's take a look back at the way it was in those early days. The challenge was to create a world-class port capable of handling visits by the heaviest objects made by man. The very large crude carriers, weighing up to 500,000 deadweight tons and drafting up to 90 feet. The result of that challenge is the King Fahad port at Yanbu. It stretches over 9 miles of coastline and gives the kingdom a priceless alternate outlet on the Red Sea with safe access to the world's shipping lanes. It also has allowed the country to move away from an economy based solely on the export of oil. Today, the port beckons to ships from throughout the world who take on refined products as well as crude oil. Other ships deliver various cargo and even modules for the expansion programs at the power and water and industry. Construction of the port was a massive undertaking. Conditions at first were primitive, and before the labor camps were built, workers lived offshore on a huge barge hotel. Pile drivers loudly pounded acres and acres of steel pilings into the sea floor, and massive concrete beams and slabs were poured. Trucks worked throughout the day and night, hauling huge rocks from the nearby mountains to form the shoreline. 7 terminals and 25 berths were constructed. 4 of the terminals were to receive and ship liquid products. The general cargo and container terminal with 7 berths include roll-on, roll-off, heavy lift, conventional cargo, and cellular container vessels. A service harbor and marine support facilities were constructed, and an export port was built. An impressive fleet of 15 tugboats and 18 auxiliary craft to carry out docking and piloting was built for the Yanbu port in shipping centers as far away as Singapore. There were also firefighting and other support vessels. In just a few short years, what had been a beautiful but barren setting was transformed into a world energy center and a focal point of shipping and trade. The construction of the King Fahad port at Yanbu was a milestone that won't soon be forgotten. It makes the task of supplying energy to the world seem almost commonplace. Any city must begin with power and water systems, especially so when it is located in a desert kingdom where water is more precious than oil. At Yanbu, every drop of water and every megawatt of electricity must be manufactured on the project. The city's power plant, located on a 25-acre site adjacent to the port, is thus the heartbeat of the city. That's 115 kV switchyard building is the pump that distributes the power throughout 275 miles of underground cable and substations. Its construction was one of the early milestones of the Royal Commission at SAPL. The butterfly valves in the substructure of its pump house weigh up to 55 tons each. 10 huge vertical pumps, 6 of them 7,500 horsepower strong, are each as high as a city bus. Seawater piping is up to 12 feet in diameter and carries enough water each hour to fill 200 Olympic-sized swimming pools. The seawater inlet facility serves as a cooling medium for industry, for the steam plants, and for the desalinization facilities. Drinking water is produced by 8 land-based desalinization units, including 2 new ones, and the Algebra desalinization barge is still in service. 6 used tanks at the plant site and 8 tanks in the buffer zone store potable and processed water. 3 pumping stations and some 373 miles of potable water lines distribute the water throughout the community. 840 megawatts of electricity is produced with gas turbines and steam turbines. Continued growth at Yanbu depends on an ample supply of power and water. The new desalinization units have been constructed. The major new industry is on hold until more power is available. Approval and funding of 2 new steam power units to support this increased demand for electricity is now a top priority by SAPL and the Royal Commission. As any visitor today can see, nothing stands still at Yanbu. It is constantly changing, and nowhere is this more apparent than in its community areas. The current home construction boom is dramatically changing the face of the city. It is fueled by needs of the major industries who are developing entire neighborhoods to house their employees. Today, this expansion phase has just begun, with 2,000 new homes under construction. These generous housing programs came just in time, for with over 34,000 persons residing on-site at Yanbu, the present Royal Commission-built housing has been filled to capacity for years. This includes the interim housing at Alnawa Village, which is now considered permanent housing. All this increased housing demand is a welcome period of rejuvenation at Yanbu. The need is so great that already more infrastructure, such as power, substations, streets, sidewalks, and lighting is needed for the city to continue to grow. And even though 6 new schools are under construction at present, there is a continuing need for additional classrooms. This new growth at Yanbu, in turn, has provided a stimulus for construction of more shopping souks by the private sector. Most ex-SAPL employees will, of course, remember the community from the early days when they were learning to pronounce such names as Hayal Samari, Hayal Radwa, and the like. These were the days when the skyline seemed permanently streaked by a half dozen or so mantis-like construction cranes, lifting high the precast concrete sections of the houses that seemed to sprout like blades of grass. Workers scampered about everywhere, their faces protected from the sun by heavy scarves. Bulldozers, buses, and trucks dotted the landscape. These were golden years at Yanbu, a time when gratifying sounds of major construction rang out across the project. Wondrous vacations, stimulating home entertainment, the glitter of bracelets, necklaces, and puzzle rings in the gold souks, and, on the weekends, the lure of the Red Sea and the nearby Hejaz Mountains and desert plains. It was a time of promise and fulfillment. Yanbu Al-Bahr, which means Yanbu by the sea, Yanbu on Akol, Yanbu in the mountains, Yanbu Al-Sinaiyah, Yanbu industrial city, a montage of city inhabitants as unlike and as similar as the shifting desert sands touching both the Red Sea and the parallel Hejaz mountains. It is here that SAPL was given the daunting task of recruiting, housing, and caring for employees from around the globe to manage one of the largest construction jobs ever attempted. A balancing act in a faraway land involving not only the work, but attending to social, cultural, and personal and financial needs of a widely diverse group of expatriates, all part of the building of an infrastructure for a modern world energy center in a world of its own, a montage of beauty and of rugged realities, of work and pleasure. Fish are auctioned off each morning on the Cornish Road as the fishing dhows return with their catch from the bountiful Red Sea. These fishermen have formed a group known as the Yanbuawi Chorus, and they have become so popular they entertain when the king or the royal personages come to town. Sacks of dried dates are loaded on the dhows, and along with rice and fish, sustain the fishermen often for weeks at a time.
وهذا 100 1 10 20 25 200 30 31 33 34 35 34
هلا خلي صورك رجال هلا
هذا حدا يا
Yanbu by the sea, has been known as a port city for at least 2,500 years. Its early importance was based on fishing and trade, but it was later to become famous as a major port for the Hajj, the annual pilgrimage for Muslims to Mecca and Medina. The growth of the city continued through the 19th century into the closing era of the Turkish Ottoman Empire, when invading Turks controlled most of Arabia. The market, or souk, formed the heart of the town. A mosque, with its minaret, the highest point in the town, was in the center of the souk. It's the same way today in all of Arabia. Many of the buildings remaining in the old part of town date from this late period. These were tall, elegant houses of Arabian merchants, built of coral blocks in the traditional style of the region, with ornate wooden balconies and shutters. The home of T.E. Lawrence, the legendary Lawrence of Arabia, is here. It is one of the four selected for restoration. When Lawrence and the Saudis destroyed the old Turkish railroad in the Hejaz Mountains near here, and the pilgrims found new routes to the holy cities, Yanbu al-Bahr was almost written off as a relic of the past. And while today it has blossomed 8 times as large as just over a decade ago because of its new neighbor down the road, its past is still quietly slipping away. It still lingers, though, in the old town. Thank you. Saudis have traditionally been traders, and they still are today. Of all their wares, perhaps gold is the most attractive to expatriates. In the early days of construction at Yanbu, gold jewelry could be had for just the price of the metal itself. Today there is a charge for workmanship, but it's still considered a bargain when compared to prices back home. The history of Saudi Arabia had already begun when Europe was still covered with ice. There were a nomadic people, proud, independent, inured to hardship and largely self-sufficient, who lived around the edges of the centers of the civilization on the Tigris, the Euphrates, the Nile, and the Indus rivers. The Bedouins of today are their descendants. There are perhaps 20,000 of these Bedouins living in the Yanbu region today, many of them still in tents and other in houses fashioned of concrete blocks or plywood. Some now live in the same land year-round, but other nomadic tribes still follow the seasonal desert trails to find grass and water to feed their sheep, goats, and camels. Very tribal, they resist the calls to come into the modern cities of concrete and glass. They will be gone soon, these gentle vagrants of the desert. Whipped by the winds, their history too will be covered by the desert sands. And for a while, no one will even notice.
Thank you.
Those who lived here were among the first city dwellers in Arabia. They're long gone, but through word of mouth, from generation to generation, the old Bedouins have handed down lessons that preserve the old customs, religion, and way of life. And the date-growing regions of the Jaz Mountains near Yanbu are a treasure hoard of old oasis villages, abandoned years ago when the springs went dry after decades of use. In these historic villages, with their splendid fortress-like roofs and walls, arched passageways, shaded paths, and awe-inspiring yet simple mosque, there was once both majesty and charm in abundance. If you look, it still exists today.